is it?
It's me, Shere Khan.
Colonel Hottie, if you please, sir. It's Baloo!
You better believe it.
Crazy.
It swings.
Hey!
It sings.
I want to be like you.
The jungle is jumping with the behind-the-scenes story of Walt Disney's masterpiece, The Jungle Book. Rudyard Kipling's 1894 classic first caught Walt's attention in the late 1930s, but Disney didn't acquire the film rights until 1962. The Jungle Book was the last animated feature that Walt Disney personally supervised. As was often the case with his animated features, Walt's first approach to the story was through music.
When I think of The Jungle Book, actually one of the first things I think about is the songs. There have been hit songs in Disney films before, many, many, many times. But it's not so much that these were hits as that they really created kind of like centerpieces in the film. They're high points, and they're things you take with you and remember.
The music is part and parcel of the film. They're wedded to each other. The characters, the personalities that sprang from the songs.
The music that we know today wasn't the first score written for the film. For an early version of The Jungle Book, composer Terry Gilkison created a dark and mysterious song score. At the same time, veteran storyman Bill Peet created a lush and moody visual approach to the classic story, firmly based in Kipling. But it seemed that this literal approach to the story wasn't what Walt had in mind. All the initial development was abandoned, except for one song.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife.
Walt called on staff songwriters Robert and Richard Sherman for a fresh musical start.
We have one wonderful song called The Bare Necessities that Terry Gilkison wrote. We said, great, so what do you want us to do? He says, well, I want you to do all the other songs in the picture. But there's one very good song in it, and it's a wonderful song. And so that's the one remaining song from the original version. All the other five were written by Bob and myself.
March and drill over field and hill.
With The Jungle Book, what most interested Walt were the memorable characters and exotic settings. In reapproaching the story development, Walt gave an unusual instruction to his staff.
Commie's offered to give me the assignment, and he held up the book by Rudyard Kipling, and he said, first thing I want you to do is not read the book.
The first question out of his mouth was, have you read The Jungle Book? Why, Rudyard Kipling said, God, no, not for ages. I saw a movie years ago with Sabu in it. And he says, yeah, but have you read it? No. He says, that's good. I don't ever want you to read it. This is the story about a kid who gets raised by wolves, and he's brought back to a man village. That's the basic storyline, and we want to have fun with it.
Since it was Walt's idea to disregard the original Kipling story, he became personally involved in solving story problems for the Disney version of The Jungle Book.
Walt says to us, leave that story business to me. You guys just get the personality relationships between the bear and Mowgli and so forth, and I'll take care of the rest of that.
Following these instructions from the boss, director Wolfgang Reitherman began developing the characters.
I went for personality, strong characterization, strong voices that fit the character.
But selecting a credible voice for a character wasn't as easy as simply casting the latest popular actor.
You want a voice which sounds real, sincere.
While discussing voice casting with his team, Walt had an inspiration.
Walt was in a meeting and we were trying to get this character of Baloo the bear. And Walt said, why don't you get Phil Harris? Well, this was sort of a new idea. It's a lot easier when you get a built-in personality that Harris brought to us.
I get this call, and they said, we want you to come out the studio, and they said, we want you to play the part of the bear, Baloo, in the Jungle Book. And I said, I can't do it. It just doesn't feel natural, and I left. About a week later, I get a call again. They said, Phil, Mr. Disney says that you're the guy he wants for that bear. Will you please try it again? And I said, well, do you mind if I do it the way I would do it? And they said, go ahead and try it. I said, look, kid, you keep fooling around in here with these animals. Why, that monkey will eat you. You know, I mean, you'll get your roof knocked in.
Now, I want you to keep circling or I'm going to knock your roof in again. You better keep moving.
And the guy said, that's exactly what we want.
Hey, right on the button.
He said, he's always doing this kind of stuff, you know, where he's snapping his fingers and jogging up and down, always working to the beat.
Yeah. Well, man, what a beat.
So that really proved to be the key thing to that character. From then on, wherever we could, we had him working to music and to beat.
I mean the bare necessities or Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.
Another inspiration came in the casting of King Louie.
We said, let's do Dixieland, you know, wild, way out Dixieland beat and all kinds of funny jive talk. And we make a whole crazy, the king of the swingers. The ape would be the king of the swingers.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, oh, the jungle VIP.
And who would be the right person? And someone suggested Louis Prima, because he was this wild swinging cat who played in Las Vegas and Tahoe. So we went out to Las Vegas, and I remember we sat down with these wild characters in this little room where we were playing a song, and Bob and I were singing away, ooh, 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 I want to be like you, ooh, ooh. And they were just listening very intently, and when it was all over, Louis Prima says, what do you want to do, make a monkey out of me? And so we said, yes. He says, you got me.
In this rare film footage shot during the recording session for I Want to Be Like You, Louis Prima and his band display their trademark eccentricity. Director Wooly Reitherman recalled the spark of an idea.
Louis would always bring his band down in a serpentine and walk down through the audience and in between the aisles even. And he'd do the horn at the lead of it and the musicians all following him. It was always a grand finale to his act.
Inspired by Prima's band, the animators took over.
Be like you.
Hop-de-hoop-de-doo-bop.
I want to walk like you.
Cheep.
Talk like you.
Choo-choo. Weepy-dee-bee-doo-boo.
You see, it's true.
Shoo-bee-dee-doo.
An ape like me.
Scooby-dooby-dooby.
Can't learn to be human too.
The unconventional approach to voice casting continued with the villainous tiger, Shere Khan.
An extraordinary performance.
We want a sinister type character, a menace. To help build our story of and a boy getting in trouble with him.
They were thinking of a kind of a Jack Palance type, you know, and a straight evil character who was going to kill this kid, you know, and maybe enjoy him for dinner. Ken Anderson made one drawing that he was thinking of a Basil Rathbone, kind of a supercilious, above it all tiger.
How interesting.
So I made these drawings of the tiger with that attitude, supercilious, so confident of his power, so confident of his ability that he didn't need to rant and roar. And showed them to Walt the next day, and he said, hey, that's it. He said, I know who that is. That's George Sanders. He said, and he's a friend of mine. He'll do it.
Who better than George Sanders, who was the master of urbane, suave, subtle villainy on screen?
Let me show you how it works.
No, I can't be bothered with that. I have no time for that sort of nonsense.
Some other time, perhaps.
Perhaps.
He grabs him by the throat and then scratches him with his claw up his nose, up his nostril, you know, and it's just terrible, but he's being so terribly polite and sympathetic.
The voice of Ka was provided by veteran Disney voice actor Sterling Holloway, who had played Mr. Stork in Dumbo.
Which one of you ladies is expecting?
The Cheshire Cat in Alice in Wonderland.
If you'd really like to know, he went that way.
And the beloved Winnie the Pooh.
Oh, yes, I'm rumbly in my tumbly.
Walt came to me and he was such a stickler. The voices. He said, when you finished what you're doing today on Winnie the Pooh, he said, fiddle around, see what you can do with a snake. He said, I can't get the right voice. So I thought, wouldn't it be funny to have a snake with an aching back, because it would be such a long ache.
to slow down my slithering.
Filling out the voice cast were Sebastian Cabot as Bagheera.
You have the word of Bagheera.
J. Pat O'Malley as Colonel Hottie.
And remember, an elephant never forgets.
Verna Felton as Mrs. Hottie.
Now just a minute, you pompous old windbag.
And director Wooly Reitherman's son, Bruce Reitherman, was cast as the voice of Mowgli.
I'm not as crazy as you are. Put me down!
Some people thought that perhaps Disney was taking a shortcut to creating these characters by having established voices, that is to say, established personalities, behind them. But enough time has passed now that there are so many young people who don't know anything of who those actors are, that it doesn't matter anymore. The characters now live on their own.
I still like this one better.
Bringing friendship to the screen seemed natural for two of Walt's top animators and lifelong best friends, Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston.
And it's also impressive to me that Frank and Ollie animated more than half of the picture themselves. Practically all of the scenes and sequences of Baloo and Mowgli, that wonderful relationship that develops and changes throughout the picture, was Frank and Ollie's work.
I think I'm most proud of the fact that between the two of us, we got that real warm friendship to come through. And that's what we wanted. We were both striving for that. And we both did practically all of the bear and Mowgli. And we felt would be the heart of the picture, and the warmth in a picture is what Walt always wanted us to get.
When his team was stumped for an ending to the film, Walt again stepped in, suggesting the final sequence.
He came up and improvised this ending, which is the one in the reel now where the boy meets the girl, and this is what makes him go back to the man village.
She did that on purpose, obviously.
And we all agreed that if he sees a beautiful little girl from the man village, that eternal siren song would pull him in. And as soon as we said the eternal siren song, we said, we're going to write a song for this.
I must go to fetch the water till the day that I am grown.
We had a meeting, and Walt Disney and all the other wonderful people were there. And we played it and showed the storyboards, and
that's
Walt said,
"That's the way it was.
That's the ending of the picture." That was it.
I first heard him talk about that, I thought, gee, that's tacked on. I don't know, but they gave it to me to do. And the more I fooled with it, the more I thought, God, this is a great idea, you know. And I loved the little girl, and I loved the way she would entice him. So the whole thing worked great as far as I was concerned, and it gave a wonderful ending to the picture.
Sadly, Walt Disney would not live to see this happy ending. He passed away shortly after making this final story suggestion.
Jungle Book, of course, was a very important and pivotal picture. Walt Disney died during the making of it, so the nine old men were on their own, and had that film failed, I think that Disney Animation might very well have gone down the tubes.
Executives were talking about phasing it out. Cost too much money. Anyway, there's no way to take over. You'd have to rebuild the whole team.
Disney executives took notice when The Jungle Book premiered and was an immediate blockbuster hit.
The management started getting on us and saying, what are you guys doing sitting around? Why aren't you getting some new guys in here? Not going to be anybody to animate this next picture.
Though it was the end of an era at the Disney studio, in many ways it was a new beginning. Because of the success of The Jungle Book, the Disney studio began its first formal recruiting and training programs for a new generation of Disney animators. And a triumphant future lay ahead.
Necessities, all Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.